Hi guys, and many thanks for joining me. If you're into my channel, hi, I'm Kat, and I like to talk about crimes, investigations, missing people, conspiracy theories, and everything related. Please don't forget to hit the subscribe button below. Also, make sure you hit the notification bell so you are the first one to know about any new videos I upload. And for my returning subscribers and viewers, I would like to thank you so much for all the continuous support and for the lovely comments I always receive. Thank you. Today, I want to talk to you about the one and only Clarence Mitchell. I mean, I'm pretty sure this is the entrance he would like to receive, but I'm not gonna do it. So I'm gonna say, today I'm gonna talk about Clarence Mitchell, okay? But before we get started, here is the disclaimer. I do not mean to be disrespectful to anyone I talk about in this video. This video is for entertainment and educational purposes only. The information I collect is from the internet. I compile all this information into a video, and from here on you guys are more than welcome to draw your own conclusions. Thank you. Okay, are you guys ready? Let's see what a master manipulator Clarence Mitchell can be.
Clarence Mitchell!
I mean, seriously, you do have to hand it to the guy though. He landed in the right job with the Mccanns. That's what I think. If before he was barely known nationally, now he's known all over the world thanks to his representation of the Mccanns. But, you know, he always got involved with or around dodgy people, in my opinion, really. And his latest stand, so to speak, is with Cambridge Analytica. But we'll talk about this a bit later on in the video. Obviously, as I'm trying to be fair to everyone, I'm gonna start with his younger years. I don't even know if it's correct. Is it correct? Younger years? I mean, never mind, you guys get it anyway. In 1982, Mitchell was a volunteer at the Hendon and Finchley Times when he first came in contact with Margaret Thatcher. In the late 80s, he was a BBC regional reporter in Leeds. He moved to London where he covered stories about the royals, including the killing of Diana Spencer. A 2007 article on the BBC website by Laurie Margolis about him says, and I quote, "Clarence was also a presenter on various BBC news programs, looking to make that his main career. The presenting world is a precarious and capricious one, however, and he never quite made it. Once I was working throughout the night, Clarence was presenting hourly bulletins on BBC News 24. He did the 1 a.m. and 2 a.m. but at 3 a.m. a slightly disheveled looking producer appeared doing the news. It turned out Clarence closed his eyes, sleeping through the 3 a.m. bulletin, which he was supposed to present, by the way." Okay, moving on. But sounds about right, dear Clarence, in my opinion, really. I mean, I do have to keep saying it, in my opinion, but to me, it sounds about right. Okay. Then Clarence left the BBC suddenly, and he became the Labour government's director of its media monitoring unit at the Central Office of Information. There, his job was so very important to correct, and this is quote, and I quote, "to correct bad media stories about the government and to put out the government line." In other words, nothing against the government to go out in the press. They need to look like the good guys. Sounds familiar? No wonder I said in my previous videos it smells like Clarence Mitchell, because when it smells fishy, usually is fishy. And in May 2007, he was suddenly seconded to the Foreign Office to work as the Mccanns' chief PR man, assisting another Mccann spokeswoman, Justine McGuinness. In September 2007, in an unusual move, he resigned from the civil service to become the Mccanns' full-time spokesman on a salary of £75,000 a year. You know, I always wondered why did he leave so suddenly. The strange thing is that if indeed, let's say, Madeleine was abducted and missing, she could very well be found and returned after a week or a month or I don't know. But how do you leave a job to work for someone where you might not have a job in weeks? I mean, you know what I mean? You don't just leave a job for something which is not as reliable. I don't know. Unless, I mean, this gives you a bit of thinking, isn't it? Unless he knew Madeleine is not coming back. He remained in this role with the Mccanns, but he was also employed by another major PR agency, Freud Communications. Yes, Freud. But this guy was actually Matthew Freud, the owner of the PR agency, the son of Sir Clement Freud. I really don't even think that he deserves this title anymore, to be honest with you. I don't even know why he even got it in the first place. And yes, again, we bump into someone familiar. The same Clement Freud that Kate and Jerry Mccann visited in his villa after Madeleine's disappearance. Allegedly, Freud told the Mccanns there will be nothing to tie them with the dog findings in Madeleine's disappearance. It's not like the dogs are going to answer yes or no to the police questions, you know. Freud was actually mocking the dogs, as it seems. No wonder Jerry said what he said in an interview with Sandra, and I'm pretty sure you guys know already the famous line, "Ask the dogs, Sandra." Yes, ask the dogs. But anyway, here is the video.
How can you explain the coincidence of the scent of the cadaver felt by British and not Portuguese dogs?
Sandra, maybe you should be asking the judiciary because they've examined all this.
But don't you, so you don't have any explanation for that?
Ask the dogs, Sandra.
Ask the dogs, no, Jerry. Now I think that I feel free to ask you.
Ask the dogs, Sandra. Ask the dogs, Sandra.
But you know what? Clarence Mitchell was the one who allegedly warned the Mccanns not to associate with Freud anymore because he was linked to pedophilia and of course he wouldn't look good on the Mccanns. I mean, this is PR at its best. What can I say, really? But hold on, this is not everything. I told you there were some dodgy things surrounding Clarence Mitchell. The same Laurie Margolis also noticed that Clarence Mitchell had some strange association with controversial murder cases. And she says, and I quote, "He was closely involved with the Fred and Rosemary West case, where a murderous couple had killed young girls and buried the bodies under their patio in Gloucester. He was one of the first reporters to arrive at Gowan Avenue, Fulham, in southwest London, when the immensely popular BBC TV presenter Jill Dando was shot dead in a murder many feel has never been satisfactorily explained. Mitchell also covered in depth the arrest and conviction of mass murderer Dennis Nilsson. When Paula Yates' partner Michael Hutchence died in mysterious circumstances in the Ritz-Carlton Hotel in Sydney, Australia in 1999, Clarence Mitchell was dispatched to cover the death. In a story he worked on right up to the day he left the BBC, Clarence led coverage of the murder of the Surrey schoolgirl Millie Dowler in 2002, and the case has never been solved. Mitchell also wrote books on the Fred and Rosemary West and Jill Dando cases. Oh, so I get it now. This is where Kate's idea of writing a book came from, I think. Clarence Mitchell also reported extensively on the murder by Ian Huntley of Soham Girls, Jessica Chapman and Holly Wells. On the 9th of January 2010, The Independent ran an article titled "Remember Clarence Mitchell?" And it said, and I quote, Clarence Mitchell, formerly of the BBC and now spokesman for Madeleine McCann's parents, has developed a nice little niche as a spin doctor of misery. First, he took on Fiona McKeown, mother of teenager Scarlett Kelling, who was murdered in Goa. Then, he started representing the parents of murdered London teenager Jimmy Mitson. And today we've discovered that Mr. Mitchell is also speaking for the wife of Jeremy Hoyland, the British jet skier who went missing off the coast of Bali last October. Mr. Mitchell is not charging for his services, but his presence can hardly be reassuring, the PR equivalent of an angel of death. In 2012, he becomes the director of Swanswell Charitable Trust, based in Warwickshire, dealing with people with alcohol, drugs and addiction problems. One interesting thing found in this charity's financial accounts is the £759,000 worth of computer equipment, with approximately £20,000 more having been bought in 2014. So I wonder, if you are a charity, what or on earth do you need all this computer equipment for? It's a charity. It's not Google where the work is a computer or on a computer. I mean, I don't care. It's £759,000 for computer equipment for a charity which deals with alcohol and drugs. No, it doesn't make sense. I think something really, really weird happened there. Yep. Also, have you heard of Gary Harland? He was employed by the Mccanns for his expertise in money laundering. Why an expert in money laundering was needed to find Madeleine, I have no idea whatsoever. Oh my God, I can't even get my head around this. This is just, oh. And I want to quote here from one of Harland's own articles in a British newspaper. Money launderers are extremely well-funded, well-advised, and make use of technically elaborate and sophisticated schemes to cover their tracks. Like, maybe, let's say, for example, an imagined scheme for the disappearance of a small child to help launder millions, or even a reputed charity that is supposed to help people recover from alcohol and drugs? Oh yeah, which actually brings me to the Find Madeleine Fund. I now know why this wasn't made a charity. On 14th of May 2007, the Mccanns lawyers approached the... But before I say it, I want to point this out first. Because I can't get it out of my head. They moved so quickly after Madeleine's disappearance, isn't it? I mean, on the 14th of May, they already have lawyers. I don't think I've ever heard of such a thing before, really. But anyway, yeah. On that day, the lawyers approached the charity commission, right? And here is how it goes. We were first approached for our advice about the possibility of a fund to assist the parents' search on Monday, 14th of May, explained a spokeswoman from the commission. We held discussions with the family's lawyers, and in the end, they decided not to pursue that route. But hear this out, yeah? Do you know why they wanted to make it a charity in the first place? My opinion. For the gift aid, which is sort of a tax relief charities receive, and it works something like this. For every £1 received, the charity claims back from the government 28p. It might sound to you a little, but if you start calculating, you know, like 10 times that, then 100 times that, then 1 million times and so on. There's loads of money there. It really is. But they had to make it a limited company because they had no choice. So they are liable for paying taxes. They did try, however, to pursue the treasury, but it was refused. They tried so many things. And being a private company, the money can be spent however they see fit. The memorandum of association is so wide that really any expenditure could be approved by the board of directors. And who was on this board of directors? Because as they said, and you'll see later on in the video, independent, but they are not independent at all. Okay, let's see, who are they? I'm gonna put it on the screen as well. Peter Hubner, a retired consultant, friend of the Mccanns, appointed on 21st of May 2007, but he resigned on 19th of September 2010. Then we have Brian Kennedy, a retired head teacher, Kate's great uncle, appointed on the 16th of May 2007. John Mccann, a medical representative, who is also Jerry's brother, was appointed on the 16th of May 2007 and resigned on 23rd of July 2010. Esther McVie, managing director of a public relations and communications company, Kate's school friend, appointed on the 20th of June 2007. She resigned and she was replaced by Edward Smithhurst. Edward Smithhurst, commercial law specialist with wealthy McCann supporter Brian Kennedy's company, appointment announced on the 9th of January 2008. Then we also have Dr. Doug Skihan, clinical director in cardiology at Glenfield Hospital, who is none other than Jerry's boss, appointed on the 16th of May 2007. Then Philip Tomlinson, who is a retired solicitor and former coroner in Leicestershire, appointed on the 20th of June 2007. Then he resigned and he was replaced by John Corner. John Corner is a film producer and friend of the Mccanns. The wife is a longtime friend of Kate's and godparent to the twins Emily and Sean, appointment announced on the 9th of January 2008. Reportedly drafted in to help Clarence Mitchell look at offers they have received, such as making a docudrama or writing a book. Michael Lynette, a retired accountant, appointed on the 15th of August 2007. Jerry Mccann, father of Madeleine Mccann, appointed on the 12th of November 2008. Then we have Kate Mccann, the mother of Madeleine Mccann, and the company secretary is BWB Secretarial Limited, appointed on the 15th of May 2007. Now, you can tell there on the screen there's number one and number two. Number two, Limited, was set up as director on the 15th of May, but then resigned the next day on the 16th of May 2007. However, BWB Secretarial Limited is still is to this date on their company. Now you can have a look at the most recent filing for the company for the year up to 31st of March 2019. Let's see some of the things they spend our money on, because in the end, these are from public money. The fund's organizers have refused to say how much money have spent overall. However, the money donated by the public are made available for the family's living expenses, which makes me wonder, what's included as living expense? In October 2007, according to Clarence Mitchell, there were two payments made to pay for their mortgage, total of £4,000, but the board of directors were not prepared to divulge the information. But Clarence Mitchell must have got it from somewhere. I mean, he wasn't on the board of directors, but he got it from somewhere. The legal fees for setting up the company were paid from the same fund, and then a separate fund with donations from wealthy people such as Sir Richard Branson was used for their legal team defending them against the Portuguese allegations. At one point, Clarence Mitchell's salary was paid by the business tycoon Brian Kennedy. Flies. Oof. The Madeleine Fund also paid for the Mccanns' campaign trips to Madrid, Amsterdam, Berlin, Washington DC, and the Moroccan capital Rabat, publicity campaigns, and so many others over the years. If I would point out all of them, we'll be here for weeks, so I'll just end with these expenses. But one last thing before I do. up to January 2008. And I know it's a very long time ago, but just for you to get an idea. Over 1,200,000 pounds came from merchandise sales, plus interest, although it's difficult to know the exact amount. Then the settlement from the Express Group Media was 550,000 pounds, over 500,000. These incomings were probably higher due to interviews, donations, but obviously they were not publicly declared. I know for one that there was the book deal, which made them between 500,000 pounds to 1,000,000 pounds, and then there were some other incomings there, but obviously since they are not declared, there's no way to know for sure. And then let's look at the outgoings here. 300,000 pounds for setting up the fund for miscellaneous expenses and for promotional stuff. I mean, I don't know, what do you need 300,000 pounds for setting up the fund? I mean, you're setting up a limited company or a private company, whatever, but that definitely doesn't cost that much. And what's the miscellaneous expenses anyway, which can cost 300,000 pounds? Seriously. And the promotional stuff? Then we also have 51,000 pounds fees to Justin McGuinness as official spokesperson, based on 350 pounds per day for 89 days, which would amount to 31,150 pounds, plus overtime payments and expenses, which include bar and restaurant bills for 19,850. Oh wow, those restaurants must have been expensive. Then we also have 300,000 pounds paid for Metodo 3, which was based on a 6-month contract, which means that it was around 50,000 pounds per month. Then we also have the 4,000 pounds mortgage payments plus living expenses, which we don't know how much those were, which makes the total roughly to about 655,000 pounds for the outgoings, for the expenses. But then again, we can't know the exact amounts. Could be more, could be less. I would really be curious to know. I already got bored of the financial side of it. But anyway, I finish with the financial side of it. But looking back at it, I don't know why, but it really does make me feel not like a missing child's money being spent on finding that child, but more like I would be looking at a celebrity. Which is funny, but also is not funny. But I wonder how many missing children are really getting the same funds to be found over this long period of time. How fair is it to the other missing kids that our money are being spent only for one missing child who most of us know she'll never be found, and there won't be any closure to this? I agree with spending the money for Madeleine, don't get me wrong, but I don't think it's fair that all this money are being spent only on finding her instead of them thinking about all the other kids who are missing and they don't have any support whatsoever. Okay, going back to Clarence Mitchell. He did a lot of things for the Mccanns in Madeleine's case. He played a key role in arranging for the Mccanns to meet the Pope on 28th of May 2007, just 25 days after Madeleine Mccann was reported missing.
As you can just see, Kate Mccann there on the pontiff's right-hand side.
Dovrebbero essere proprio questi che vediamo. Il Papa legge sul loro volto l'angoscia. Osserviamo, stringe le mani. Ecco la bambina.
He is a man with connections at the highest level. Clarence Mitchell openly boasted in a TV interview that it was him who arranged via Roman Catholic Archbishop Cormac Murphy O'Connor for the Mccanns to visit the Pope in what was a highly publicized visit. And check this out. The Pope put pages of material about the Mccanns and Madeleine on his website. Okay? But, I love this but, this word, this but. But, 2 days before the Mccanns were made arguidos in September 2007, the Pope deleted all references to Madeleine from his website. How could he have known 2 days before they were made arguidos? I don't get it. That's weird. Okay. Margolis wrote in 2007, and I quote, "I would imagine Clarence is content in his new role as the family's voice. He sent a stage on a huge story, intimately involved as ever, and on television and in the papers all the time. It was extraordinary how, last week, his intervention seemed to eliminate within hours any misgiving about the Mccanns in the British media." Oh my God. That tells you something, doesn't it? Really. How he carried on, and probably still carries on, keeping the good and innocent portrayal of the Mccanns in the British media. Not only that, but I think with how many media outlets the Mccanns sued and how much money they made for winning libel cases, the media outlets are even scared now to add anything negative about them. Not only that, but let's face it, most of these media outlets are owned by the government. There's always the government, you know. And I say it again, the government get involved so much in something only when it's beneficial to them and only them. Oh my God, but how much I hate politics. I really do. Whenever I was thinking, okay, you know, I'm gonna start a YouTube channel, right? My first instinct was always to say, no, I'm gonna stay away from politics. I just can't get involved in politics. I just hate politics. But yet, you see, here I am. Madeleine's case is leading me in the direction I hoped I all need to get to. When I first started researching this case, I never imagined for a second that politics will have anything to do with the case. And how wrong was I? I was so wrong. Everything about this revolves around politics. And the only one forgotten is Madeleine. Such a shame. It's a real shame. This is not about finding her anymore, in my opinion. No, I think that this is just a game of politics and how far politics is involved in a missing child case. This is disgusting beyond belief. It's disgusting beyond belief. You know, I pointed out earlier that Clarence Mitchell was being paid by Brian Kennedy. But there was a time when he said that he's paid by an anonymous backer. However, in an article from The Independent on Sunday, 1st of March 2009, Mitchell contradicts himself. What a liar, and he got caught up in his own lie. For God's sake, I say it again, if you lie, at least lie properly. Don't allow yourself to get caught. What a joke. What a joke. He then said he gets a retainer of £28,000 a year from the Helping to Find Madeleine Fund, donations which were given to help find Madeleine. But these donations were not given to pay the salaries of PR professionals. Come on! This right here is where the money is going. And we pay for this. And we pay for this whole circus. And we are still paying for it. For God's sake! But I bet, if your child or my child would go missing, knock on wood that it happens. Let me find some wood. Yeah, I have a table here. Knock on wood that it happens, we would not see a single penny. What to talk about media coverage? What to talk about international coverage? No, this doesn't normally happen. It doesn't. Allegedly, Clarence Mitchell was involved in tipping the Mccanns off that the Portuguese police were monitoring their emails and phone calls. And I have to say it again. Innocent people do not need tipping off. They don't. Innocent people have nothing to hide. They have nothing to fear. This in itself raises suspicions to me. And this in itself makes me believe that Clarence Mitchell knows what happened. It was Clarence Mitchell who was also forced to deny the Mccanns' initial claim of a break-in on the evening that Madeleine was reported missing. The Mccanns said an abductor broke into the children's room by jamming open the shutters. That they repeated that claim so many times, a claim which the media reported extensively. But the managers of the Mark Warner's resort where the Mccanns were staying and the police soon discovered that the shutters had not been tampered with. This forced the Mccanns to dramatically change their story, one of many changes of stories, and later said the abductor must have walked in through an unlocked patio door. Asked about this discrepancy, Mitchell was forced to say on record, and I quote, "There was no evidence of a break-in. I'm not going into detail, but I can say that Kate and Jerry are firmly of the view that somebody got into the apartment and took Madeleine out the window as their means of escape. To do that, they did not necessarily have to tamper with anything. They got out of the window fairly easily." Oh my God. I think that's unlikely for an abductor to get out of the window without leaving any traces, especially in that little time he allegedly had, according to their statements and their timeline and whatever. Oh, I can't deal with this. This is just... Okay, let's carry on. A surprising move was targeting Robert Murat, where, of course, Clarence had a hand in. Well, of course, Clarence Mitchell. When I say that it smells like him, it's him! Laurie Campbell, a journalist working closely with Mitchell, suspected Murat and reported him to the police. But not the Portuguese police. She actually called Leicestershire police to report him, and Leicestershire police in turn contacted the PJ. I mean, why so much going around? I don't have any idea. Laurie was in Portugal at that time, so why not go straight to the PJ? Yeah, I understand the language barrier, and I say it again like in one of my other videos. Yes, there is a language barrier, but I'm pretty sure that someone somewhere in that police station would know two words of English for her to report Robert Murat. That's what I think. Then, of course, it happened. Three of the Tapa 7 came forward saying they saw Murat in the vicinity of the Mccanns' apartment on the night of Madeleine's disappearance, which of course Murat denied. And this is what Clarence Mitchell had to say, and I quote, "An outcome similar to Holly and Jessica Soham, children murdered by Ian Huntley, is possible. I don't want to, and I can't talk about Robert Murat, but some journalists who worked with me in Soham and that were now in Portugal saw resemblances between that case and Robert Murat, and I won't say more." And that's end of quote. So that's why Laurie Campbell was saying Murat behaved really strangely, just like Ian Huntley did. And that was enough for her to consider him suspicious. But of course, grasping at any straws they can find, of course. Mitchell was also forced to deny the claim he made in 2008 that Madeleine was probably dead. This, of course, caused grave embarrassment to the Mccanns, who want more than anything publicly to be known that they believe Madeleine is missing. Otherwise, they can say bye-bye to the funding, bye-bye funding. Jerry Mccann was forced to publicly rebuke his PR chief by insisting on his blog 2 days later that they remained hopeful that Madeleine was still alive. But of course he did. No missing Madeleine, no more funding. How smart, right? Then we also have the interview by James Whale, where Mitchell refused to correct Whale when he referred to the Mccanns Fund as a charity. I wonder why that might be. Is it because perhaps this would change the public opinion about them? Because not that many people know. I mean, I'm not sure, but I believe that not so many people know that Madeleine's Fund is in fact not a charity but a private company. And I think the reason why he refused to correct Whale was because for them, for him and the Mccanns, it's all about the looks, isn't it? All about the looks. How they are perceived by people, because the donations are from people. And you know, one wrong turn and people will change their opinion. It's not surprising that after they were declared suspects, a lot of the donations dropped in numbers, which goes to show that people can change their opinions very easily. And the Mccanns' relationship with the public is quite fragile, in my opinion. Clarence Mitchell also made a mockery of the donations in the same interview by James Whale. When asked how people can contribute to the fund, Mitchell said, and I quote, "Just put money into an envelope and send to Kate and Jerry Mccann Rotley. It will get there." Now that was really unprofessional and also sarcastic. And in my opinion, sarcasm shouldn't have a place in a missing child's case. This is not acceptable. But the same goes for the Mccanns and Clement fraud, really. It also shows that they couldn't care less, that these are their money and they can spend them as they want, in my opinion. I mean, we did cover this earlier in the video, but Clarence Mitchell also claimed that the fund was independently controlled. But as you've seen, this is a lie, it's not true. The board of directors consists mainly of family, friends and acquaintances. When the Mccanns were trying to show the whole world they are not guilty of Madeleine's disappearance, Clarence Mitchell announced, and I quote, this is a good one, "Kate and Jerry Mccann would have no issue with taking a lie detector test. However, 2 months later," oh, this is so embarrassing. Not for me, it's not for me. "However, 2 months later," he announced, and I quote again, "of course they are not going to take any lie detector test." Oh my God, he's contradicting himself again, only 2 months apart. For God's sake. Oh my God. Oh, and we see this again. But I think that the Mccanns were willing at one point to take a lie detector test only if it was fully controlled by them, meaning the questions to be said by them. Who is gonna arrange such a lie detector test? Questions to be controlled by them. What's that? That's not a lie detector test anymore. Clarence Mitchell also told the media, and I quote again, I love quotes today, "The Mccanns don't want to do anything about Woe Is Us a year on. That is what the tabloids would like us to do, but we are not following their agenda. We are following our own agenda. So there is an agenda." But guess what? Weeks later, there was a 2-hour long pre-recorded TV interview. Madeleine Mccann, 1 year on, clearly prepared long before Mitchell's public statement and certainly with personal knowledge. Mitchell also claimed, and I quote again, "Whatever the Portuguese police might find in their investigation, the Mccanns will have an innocent explanation for it." And he also added a comment here, and I quote again, "There are wholly innocent explanations for any material that the police may or may not have found." Which begs the question, how could the Mccanns and Clarence Mitchell know in advance that any evidence the police might find would have an innocent explanation? How? Clarence Mitchell also claimed it doesn't matter if Kate changed her clothes on the night of 3rd of May. One of the key issues in the Madeleine Mccann case is whether the Mccanns and their Tapa 7 friends have been telling the truth. the whole truth and nothing but the truth about the events of 3rd of May 2007, the day Madeleine was reported missing. In late 2008, a French journalist, Duarte Levy, claimed to have seen photos taken that evening, conclusively proving that Dr. Kate Mccann had left the table during the evening and changed her clothes. That would blow a hole in her claim that she was at the tapas bar the whole evening. She would have had to explain why she changed her clothes. Mitchell's official response to these claims was, you gotta love Mitchell for this, and I quote, "So what if she did leave the table and change her clothes?" But obviously he refused to elaborate on that. Clarence Mitchell also said that none of the tapas groups were wearing watches that night, but he was forced to retract the claim. Mitchell tried to explain by responding, and I quote, "None of them were wearing watches or had mobile phones on them that night." The journalist then confronted him with the sheer unlikelihood that all nine had neither watch nor mobile phone, pointing out that the Mccanns and others had used their mobile phones that night and produced pictures of the Mccanns and their Tapa 7 friends taken in Praia da Luz the same week, which showed that they were always, always wearing watches. And this is what Clarence Mitchell had to say. And I quote, "Some of them were wearing watches and had mobile phones, some of them weren't." On the 11th of April 2008, Clarence Mitchell also claimed, and I quote again, I told you today I love quotes, "Kate and Jerry have been utterly honest and utterly open with the police and all of their statements from the moment that Madeleine was taken." He later said, referring to himself and the Mccanns, "We have nothing to hide." When addressing a largely student audience during what were called the Coventry Conversations, Mitchell said, and I quote again, "We are always willing to cooperate with the Portuguese police." Kate Mccann was asked 48 questions by the Portuguese police when interviewed on 7th of September 2007, and she refused to answer any of them. Well, actually, she did answer one of the 49, yeah. So, I have to ask, if they are so honest and so open, then why did the Mccanns refuse to take part in a reconstruction of events? And why did their statements change so many times and there were so many contradictions with the other statements from the rest of the group? Clarence Mitchell, hear this, you have to hear this, okay? Clarence Mitchell also claimed it's a British cultural custom for parents to put children to bed early so they could enjoy the rest of the evening. Interviewed by Irish TV station RTE, Clarence Mitchell tried to explain why the Mccanns left three young children under the age of four on their own several nights in a row whilst on holiday, and they went out for the evening wining and dining. He told his TV audience, and I quote, "There is a cultural difference between Britain and Portugal. It is a British approach to get your children washed, bathed, and in bed early in the evening if you can, so you can have something of the evening to yourself. That's the British way of doing things. It doesn't mean it's wrong, it doesn't mean it's right." I can't have a comment on this one myself, because obviously you can tell by now I'm not British, but in my view, no matter how early kids go to sleep, kids of these ages shouldn't be left alone in an apartment ever, not ever, not in Britain, not in Portugal, in no country for that matter. A child is the same age in whichever country they are from or they live in. I also know that I have British viewers, so I would like to ask you now, is it true what Clarence Mitchell says? Is it really a cultural custom? Please let me know in the comments below. Thank you. And then, after all he said with the custom thing, he then claimed the children were not left alone every evening. He also tried blaming Romani gypsies for abducting her, although with no basis whatsoever, but of course he never apologized for it. Months after Madeleine went missing, another child went missing. I'm not sure if you've heard of her, Mary Luz. Clarence Mitchell used an image of Mary Luz for the Madeleine's campaign without asking permission from Mary's parents. The Mccanns printed posters of Madeleine together with Mary Luz without gaining the parents' permission. Obviously, her parents were very upset and they complained. But this is how Clarence Mitchell replies, and I quote again, "It's a shame that they are complaining about us in a press release. How can they be angry with us for wanting to help when all we are trying to do is find their own daughter?" Oh my God. Oh my God. I can't even begin to imagine how Mary's parents felt when Mitchell said that. Seriously. The worst is, they were not even trying to help in finding Mary, but they were trying to make the campaign more dramatic and to take Mary's disappearance into their spotlight. Seriously, he is just disgusting, but I mean, come on, what kind of a PR is this? PR is public relations. It's not supposed to be like this, is it? Oh my God. Sadly, Mary Luz was later found dead. So, I'm wondering, whose interests is Clarence Mitchell serving? Is he the person who is trying to help us see the truth? Or is he someone who is doing his best to stop us getting the truth? And I think you already know the answer to that. In February of this year, more money were asked from the British public by the police to carry on with the investigation of Madeleine's disappearance. This after they received £300,000 just last year. And Clarence Mitchell said, and I quote, "It is good news that the Met Police are seeking a new budget to continue the search for Madeleine. Kate and Jerry are greatly encouraged that officers still believe there is active work left to be done and do hope that the Home Office grants their request." But of course it's good news. It doesn't even surprise me. I don't know, will it ever stop? I have no idea. They're never gonna run out of money this way. Never. But before I end this video, yes, I said earlier at the beginning that I want to touch a bit on that Cambridge Analytica and Clarence Mitchell. So I'm not sure if you've heard, the Facebook Cambridge Analytica data breach was a data leak in early 2018 whereby millions of Facebook users' personal data was harvested without consent by Cambridge Analytica, predominantly to be used for political advertising. It is the largest known leak in Facebook history. And again, going into politics. Oh, but by the way, I'm quite sure that you guys know I'm in the UK, and strangely enough, one of these days I actually received an email to vote for Donald Trump. How did they even get my email if I'm not in the US? Anyway, it's out of the video subject. So, Clarence Mitchell, in this case, described himself as the face of Cambridge Analytica on Twitter. He appeared at a press conference for his clients, and in an interview with Channel 4 News, he described the operation as not being some Bond villain and said he was perfectly proud to defend the company. And he also added, and I quote, "You say, why are Cambridge Analytica not speaking to Channel 4? Well, I say, I am speaking to Channel 4. Some companies would say, we're not speaking to Channel 4 after their expose. What is that anyway? I didn't understand anything from this." What? Okay, moving on. Yes, and he also says, "Cambridge Analytica has not used a honey trap, ever. I can't discuss it whilst the independent investigation is being conducted. It would be wrong for me to prejudge it." And he carries on. "Cambridge Analytica did not harvest the data. The figure for the data received by Cambridge Analytica was mind-boggling. But I can guarantee that everything has gone from the system. It's a mess, certainly, but I am clearing up their mess for them. I've come in to assist them, to get them through this crisis where I can. So, in other words, Clarence Mitchell is well known to clear up messes. He's using government resources to control what comes out of the media and so on. And we are to believe everything. Okay, guys, that's it for today's video. Many thanks for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe by hitting the subscribe button below if you are not subscribed. Also, make sure you hit the notification bell so you are the first one to know about my next video when it will be public on my channel. And my next video will be about the Mallorca holiday in 2005, for God's sake. I'm sorry. I'm trying my best. Mallorca? Yes. You get it anyway. Thanks for watching, guys. Stay safe and take care. Bye-bye.